master your smile.
It is my pleasure today to introduce one of my favorite people, Eunice Terry, a lady who's been in Billings since 1950. And we're going to spend some time with her today and talk about where she came from, what she does, and where she's going. So I just want to tell you, I'm sure glad to see you.
Well, it's a blessing to be in your company today, to share this time of fellowship. And just to let you know a little bit about me since I hit this part of the world.
Great.
It's been great. Sometimes a struggle, but God is good, and His mercies endures forever. I was born in 1926, and my dad started each one of our children out to work at 5 years old. And you got up and you went to work. You didn't sit down. I started making beds and cleaning house at 5 years old.
Wow.
Getting in wood and water. And my mother would go to the field, and I would get in the water and the wood, and I babysit my niece and my sister, and I would get them to sleep, and I'd comb their hair. I did all of these things, and finally I would get through it, and I'd go into the garden and pick whatever my mother told me to do and get it ready for dinner. So that was my job. You were busy all day long. When you got up at 4 o'clock in the morning, you didn't go back to bed no more till around 9:30 or 10 o'clock that evening.
And what were you doing? What was the job you were doing?
You could be planting corn, or you could be chopping cotton, or you could be hoeing cotton. He was just whatever was there, peas or beans or things, or something like that. Whatever the occasion was. And we were rich spiritually, because my dad was a minister, my mother a missionary, spiritually. And I never went hungry a day in my life. We always raised enough food for us to eat. But financially, we was poor. And we didn't even know it, you know. And I had my nieces and cousins and things laughing at me the other day about my dad. If you went to the store and if the man shortchanged you a penny, and that was about a mile and a half you had to go to the store, he'd make you go back and get that penny. He'd send that statement back, make you take all of the food back, and he'd say, he owed me a penny. And he was going to get that penny. We were some loved children. You know, parents today, I don't feel like we are rearing our children properly today, because we could not talk back. Whatever our parents said, or whatever any older person said, that was gospel. And so we just could not talk back. We got a spanking or whipping. Sometimes it was whipping, wasn't a spanking. It was just plain whipping. You didn't talk back. So I can remember one day, my dad was the superintendent of the school, and every so often parents would come to school to see what the children were doing. And my brother and I, we had a friend that woman could say some things, and she said, so I can't tell you what she said, and everything. She said, I laugh so the teacher said, stop laughing, Eunice. I said, I can't. My brother and I, we just couldn't stop laughing. Finally, the teacher said, she said, well, you won't stop laughing. She said, I'm going to put you up. Then they made you stand up in the corner. They make you stand up on 1 foot like 2 hours and a half.
foot.
You better not let that foot
Amazing.
Down. No, you didn't. And my father happened to come to the school that day. And I was back there in that corner. My brother was way up on stage at another corner. He said, what are you doing standing up in the corner on 1 foot? I said, I couldn't stop laughing. He said, well, you will when you get home. Oh, Lord, I got another one when I got home. about a year and a half after my mama died, my father remarried. And I'm here to tell you, sometimes it ain't good, especially when you have children, to get that second wife or that second husband. Because I think about what the Bible said. If you got a husband, you got to tend to that husband. And then you got to see to the children. Well, when it's not the father or the mother, it's a different story. That woman didn't want my daddy even speak to us. And he told her, these are my children. He said, they mammy, they called him back daddy, their mammy dead. And said, don't you talk to my kids like that. And everything. That didn't stop her. Well, now, my mother was clean. You could eat off the floor because we got on her hands and knees and she mopped that floor every once and twice a week. We swept our yard. Our yard was cleaner than most folks keep the house. You couldn't even find a sprig in our yard. And lo and behold, this woman come in the house, and instead of sweeping the trash out the door, she'd sweep it in a corner. And throw a rug. She had a little rug, she threw it. And I had never seen that before in my life. And I said, my God. I said, why don't you just sweep that on out the door? She said, oh, I'll get that later. So I went and told my dad. Oh, Lord. I said, oh, Lord. He said, I'll take care of that. And he did. And everything, but that didn't stop her from being nasty. She couldn't wash, she couldn't iron, she couldn't cook, she couldn't do nothing. And I still had to cook my dad and wash and iron his clothes for them to look presentable. And everything, so I never, everything we did was a sin, you know. My daddy, even drinking coffee was a sin. Mm-hmm. And he said, you don't need that caffeine. Your body don't need the caffeine. That was what he called a sin, you know. So I told my brother, I said, I sure be glad when we get old enough where we can go and see what this sin is all So my sister and her husband moved from Mississippi to Chicago. And she said, she wrote us this letter and she said, if y'all want to come, she said, I'll send for you. I said, let's do it. So she sent us two tickets to come to Chicago. We left Alabama. I never will forget that day, the 14th day of February in 1945. And let me tell you, it was 45 degrees when I left at 9 o'clock in the morning. Well, we had never been in no cold weather before in our life. Didn't even own a coat. So here my brother and I and our cousin, we get on the bus. And we changed buses in Kentucky, Louisville, Kentucky. And when we got about 10 miles beyond Louisville, the man spoke on the intercom and he said, you are now past the Mason-Dixon line. And Negroes can sit in place on the bus they want. I looked at my brother and I looked back at my cousin and we said, man, this sounding pretty good. So we went on, we could sit in the place on the bus we wanted after that. So, okay. And I never was so glad to get to Chicago, but I sure wasn't enjoying that cold weather. Cold weather was something else, man. But anyway, got over that. And everything, went there and got a job and went to work. And I was making 15 cents a day. And when I got 16 years old, then they started giving me 25 cents a day. And I got in Chicago, I started making the dollar an hour. Hot dollar. I thought I was in big time.
Oh, yeah.
Man, make $8.50 a day.
Wow.
Where I had been making 25 cents a day.
Mm.
I thought I was in sim heaven.
Outstanding. And you came here. Where did you come to in Montana?
I came first to Hardin.
Mm-hmm.
And
That was your favorite place, right?
Right. he was something else there. But anyway, I weathered the storm. And the Negroes could not swim when I got here in the swimming pool till on the weekend. And the white folks would swim from Sunday until, from Monday until Saturday. And then the Negroes could swim Saturday and Sunday.
That was in Billings?
Uh-huh. At South Park School.
In South Park.
And they would drain all of the water out.
Really?
Really. And put brand new water in there for Monday morning.
Really?
And then they'd swim all the week, and now it's one thing about it, you can believe this if you wanna, but you're going to always have prejudice till there's not a breath on the face of this earth. There are some people just not going to.
Right.
They're just not gonna do that. And everything, they don't even get along with themselves much long, unless they're fellow man. And everything, and that's a bad thing. That's a bad thing. God did not give no man no monopoly over another one. And it's in the Bible, four times, God said, I have no respect to persons. And he means that. And so if we have respect to person, we are not children of God. And to me, Christian people today, a real Christian, and a lot of people won't agree with me on this, and it doesn't matter to me anymore, but a real Christian cannot be a Democrat or a Republican. I tell people I'm neither. I'm not a Democrat and I'm not a Republican. But I'll vote for a man that I think would get a job done. If I have respect to persons, then I'm going against God and his way of living, of what he told me to do. And we are supposed to love everybody. Now, I will hate what a person does, but I've got to love the man to make it into heaven. And then you have to watch that, because it's a thin line between love and hate. And I tell people, I say, don't have that faucet love. Well, see, that's where a lot of people turn your love off. If you don't do what they say, or you don't follow them and their stuff, then they get mad at you and say, well, forget him. I'm kicking him to the curb. That ain't the way God operates. Now, I'm so glad God is God all by himself. Oh, my goodness, my goodness, my goodness. I am a true follower of God. See, when I was out there in that wood doing everything I wanted to do, I thought whatever the devil told me to do, I did it.
Well.
And when I've been over here on this hallelujah side, I'm doing what God said to do. And so I can't follow sin when I know it's there. So we started our little church, All Nation Christian Fellowship Church. That's the name of our little church. And we are growing. I'm not looking for no big crowd. I'm just looking to save some souls. I'm looking to save souls. I'm not out for farm and fashion. Well, you know, my dad taught us to love, like I told you a while ago, to love. The white people done us so bad down south. My dad told us, he said, I don't care what they do to you. I don't care what they say to you. I don't care how they act to you. He said, you still reverence them and love them, but you don't like what they done, don't like what they're doing. He said, I want my children to go to heaven when they die. The devil will not do you what God will do for you. The devil, he's a hard tax master. That rascal puts something on you that you wish you hadn't. And when I was out there in the world, I did it. Whatever he told me to do, I just go do it. If it hadn't been for God being on my side, I wouldn't be here, because when that man drove that gun on me in Chicago, and I was cussing back that then, and I said, who in the so-and-so-and-so done so-and-so-and-so? And this man come up from over there, and he stood up, and he said, I did. He said, and don't nobody call me that, what you just called me. And Leo, not even my mother. Well, I don't know if you know what dozens is, but I said, you and your mother, and your mother's mother, and your mother's mother's mother, and your mother's mother. your daddy. He was there. He said, I keep telling you. And he was pulling a trigger, and God didn't let none of them go. He was fully loaded. And see, that night, I dreamed why I know God got me here for a reason today. Thank you, Jesus. Because I carried a knife, a switchblade. All I had to do was put it out of my pocket and hit the button, and then the blade would come over, and the blade was about a foot long almost. And I carried an ice pick, and I put the ice pick down in here. And I had a pistol, a 32, in my purse. And I carried every night. That night, I went out with nothing. I was asking what you SBs finna do, try to cut me and shoot me to death, you know, or I still was cussing. But God never let the gun go off. Hmm. God saved me right here at the Maple Leaf Club in the bar. Hmm. I was saved amazing. In the bar, hallelujah. Thank you, God, for bringing me off of Skid Row. When I get to heaven, meet my mother there. She said, God Almighty, here come my child. You know, she must have got here by prayer. But I'll be in heaven. I'm gonna sing a brand new song. And then we will go to the meeting around the throne. Yeah, yes, you know. I want to be at the meeting. I want to be at the meeting. I want to be at the meeting when all God's saints get home. After separation of the right from the wrong, I want to be at the meeting. Around the throne. Glory.